that have set up springs. Really happy to see everybody. This is the beginning of our new year, 2016, the West Virginia Archives and History Library Lecture Series. Now we're going to have a couple of lectures a month for a couple months, and then we're going to go back to a once a month lecture series. And of course, we're going to have some special lectures throughout that. And as time goes on, if something comes up that is a special lecture, we'll definitely put the word out there on our website and through our electronic means and things like that. Sometimes the newspapers pick it up, and sometimes they don't, unfortunately. But you know, as those come available and we get the times and the speakers and things, we will definitely get them out to you. We do have a few things coming up. January 28th, Dr. Michael Hahn, Geology Underlies It All, the West Virginia Geological and Economic Survey and Service to the Public for Over a Century. Dr. Hahn is the geologist for West Virginia. And if you deal with maps any, which that's primarily one of my things here at the archives, one of my duties is taking care of the maps. And the topo maps and the USGS and the West Virginia GS maps, he's going to talk about those and how they came about in the late 1800s and a lot of the different aspects of those maps. So if you're interested in maps, that's one that you'll definitely want to catch here. That's on January 28th. February 2nd, History of a Loudoun Heights Garden Club and Neighborhood Revisited. A lot of communities had garden clubs and things like that, and this is the history and the ongoing efforts of one of the garden clubs here in Charleston up in Loudoun Heights. That'll be put on by the members of that group. Tonight, Dr. Robert Maslowski will present Plantation Archeology, Industrial Slavery, and the Glenwood Project. I like to read these for everybody because we do have ways of taping these, and they go out on our YouTube channel. And just for, you know, if you miss something, or if you want to go back and take a look at some of the films that we have done, some of the lectures we have done, they're on our Facebook. I just remind myself when I look back in the camera there. Slave-based agriculture and the salt industry were two of the most important economic pursuits in the early history of West Virginia. Plantation slavery differed from the industrial slavery of the salt manufacturers in that many of the slaves in the salt industry were leased on a yearly basis from plantations. While most of the leased slaves came from plantation owners, or came from eastern plantations, records indicate that some local plantation owners, such as George Summers, owner of the Glenwood and Walnut Grove plantations, also leased slaves to salt makers. Dr. Maslowski will discuss and compare the results of archaeological excavations at the Jenkins Plantation on the Ohio River, the Reynolds home and the slave cabin at the Marmet Lock Replacement Project in the Glenwood Estate in West Charleston. Dr. Maslowski holds a bachelor's degree in psychology from Holy Cross College, Massachusetts, and received his doctorate in anthropology archaeology from the University of Pittsburgh. He is a retired archaeologist with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers in Huntington. Dr. Maslowski has done extensive archaeological work in the Ohio Valley on prehistoric and historic sites, and he has also worked in Trans-Pecos, Texas, Israel, Cyprus, Vietnam, and Laos. He currently teaches Appalachian courses at Marshall University Graduate College in South Charleston. Dr. Maslowski was the executive producer of three award-winning archaeology films, Red Salt and Reynolds in 2003, Ghosts of Green Bottom, 2005, and Secrets of the Valley, Prehistory of the Kanawha, in 2010. Dr. Maslowski is a former editor of the journal West Virginia Archaeologist. Please welcome Dr. Maslowski.
It's cold in here.
Oh, it's cold upstairs.
Well, you're going to have it in our library.
Okay, I'm going to talk about four different sites. The first site we'll discuss is the Albert Gulleton Jenkins House, located in Cabell County on the Ohio River. This is a photograph of the Jenkins House after it was restored by the Corps of Engineers. Jenkins was a Confederate general. Greenbottom was initially settled, actually, in 1795. It was a plantation that was owned by two governors of Virginia. And the notes for the plantation at that time are still housed at the University of Virginia. Captain Jenkins bought the land in around 1823. He built this house in 1835. It was completed in 1835. After he died, the 4,000 acre plantation was divided equally between his three sons. And Albert Gulleton got the family homestead. This is a picture of Greenbottom in 1906. You can see the house and a detached kitchen and another building next to the kitchen. It was customary at this time to put the kitchen outside of the house because of fires and so on. This is the Albert Gulleton Jenkins house around 2000 when we conducted extensive excavations through the Corps of Engineers. The Corps of Engineers got a directive from Congress that they were supposed to restore the house. The Greenbottom Society indicated that they interpreted this legislation as restoring all of the outbuildings. So the Corps of Engineers was obligated to do a number of archaeological investigations around the house to try and locate the outbuildings. This is the Jenkins Privy. It's located toward Route 2 behind the house. The house faced the river originally. It was a very interesting feature. It wasn't like your normal privies that we come across in archaeology. It had a cement floor, and it was designed so it could be emptied periodically. The consultant, Will Updike, who was in charge of this excavation, happened to find a diagram and explanation of how the privy worked from a Department of Agriculture publication in 1817. This is the kitchen area. As I said, it was detached from the house. You can see in the front from the picture a small porch was probably one of the entranceways to the kitchen and a number of interior walls. And then on the other side of the Jenkins house, you had a foundation that was for an office. Historic records indicate that the office building was built in 1850. There was a number of pieces of glass, window glass, recovered in the excavation from the office area. And you can date window glass if you get a big enough sample by taking the thickness of the glass. Gets thicker and thicker through history, and there's a formula you can plug in the average thickness and get an approximate date. The average date for this building came to 1847, within 3 years of the proposed construction date. It's interesting because the oral histories, number of the oral histories indicate that Jenkins got a law degree from Harvard, and the local historians claim that he practiced law and this was his law office. A number of historians or a number of people also indicate that he practiced law with George Summers in Charleston. And none of this has been proven. If you look at his biographies, the official biography when he was a member of Congress, says he returned home and never practiced his profession. He became a plantation owner and a farmer. He also served in the legislature at one time also. This is a cellar that was excavated near the kitchen area. And here's a diagram of the excavation showing the location of the office, a brick walkway into the privy, a garden gateway. These plantations generally had kitchen gardens near the house. And if you look at some of the records from the and historic accounts from the Glenwood house, you'll find that they were very into gardening, ordering seeds from the eastern U.S. and so on. What you get in these excavations is a lot of broken pottery, rusty nails. In this case, the Jenkins house was built on a prehistoric Indian site, so we recovered a number of prehistoric Indian artifacts also. Now the next site is the Burning Springs site. This was in West Bell. It was excavated as part of the Marmet Lock and Dam Replacement Project. Near the river you have the Reynolds Mansion. The cemetery is behind the mansion where the Reynolds family was buried. And you have the slave cabin, KA352, near the base of the bluff. And on the other side of Burning Springs, we also excavated two salt furnaces that were associated with the Reynolds occupation, we believe. Aerial photo of the mansion area shows the house foundation, the privy, another root cellar, a chimney base, which we never found out too much about what it was, a well. And also in this area, while we were excavating the historic component, we uncovered a fort ancient village and excavated the total fort ancient village. You can see the stockade vine, the palisade vine, a late prehistoric house. The village contained 25 houses, actually. We've got patterns for all of these houses. And on the east, you can see in the photo where it says large late prehistoric house, there's a gateway in the stockade line that faces east. The Reynolds house actually took part of the stockade vine. This is a close-up of the John Reynolds house. It shows an interior cellar and an exterior baking oven. This is quite common in Tidewater, Virginia. Reynolds most likely came from Tidewater, Virginia. When you're researching sites like this, with names like Reynolds and Morris, it gets very complicated because if you look at the historic records, there are six John Reynolds in the historic records. We believe this John Reynolds moved to Point Pleasant. Well, we know he moved to Point Pleasant in 1795, married a Van Vipper daughter, moved to Charleston. And one time he owned most of Charleston. He gave the land for the first courthouse and the first jail. He was a very prominent member of Charleston society in the early 1800s. This is a painting of John Reynolds. Mrs. Bird in Charleston showed us this painting. She found it at a yard sale, and the owner said, "This is one of your relatives, John Reynolds." So she bought the painting, and it is in her house today. This is the Van Vipper Reynolds house in Charleston. When we first excavated the slave cabin, we thought it may have been an earlier occupation of the Reynolds, possibly Van Vipper Reynolds, or maybe Alexander Quarrier, who moved to Charleston and lived on the Reynolds plantation, one of the Reynolds plantations in 1811. This is actually from the deeds in the county courthouse. Alexander Quarrier was the person in charge of the courthouse at that time, and he drew this picture of the Van Pepper Reynolds house. And I threw this in here because I usually use a lecture on the development of Charleston from plantations to an urban setting. And one of the things we stressed in the development was that all of the early lots were rectangular because there were no stores in the area. You had to have a place for a garden, a place for an outhouse. If you were a man of means, you had to have a place for a carriage and a horse also. And this illustrates the garden that was maintained by Van Pepper Reynolds, one of John Reynolds' sons. And this is the base of a salt furnace located in Burning Springs. Salt furnaces aren't real exciting things to excavate. Everything was removed, all of the metal, stone, and so on. All you get is a deep red stain. This stain went down something like 15 feet. We took a backhoe trench through it. The salt furnaces were maintained 24 hours a day constantly. So the fires were very hot, and the deposits underneath were burned to a very deep depth. And we also found the foundation of a slave cabin. Originally, we thought this may have been an early settler's cabin, but during the analysis of the artifacts, we found out that it was definitely a slave cabin. All of the artifacts, or most of the artifacts recovered during the excavation, indicated that it was occupied by slaves rather than one of the Reynolds families. And this is the Reynolds Cemetery, also located on that plot of land. The original land that these sites are located on were owned by George Washington. He purchased them because of the burning springs, the salt springs, and he realized that they would be very significant in terms of development of industry in the Kanawha Valley. We sold several times. Morris was an early owner, and then eventually Reynolds became the owner of the property. There was a small family cemetery on the site. It had graves for Van Pepper Reynolds, a couple of his siblings, or his daughter and wife and a son. And we had prepared to excavate the cemetery and remove a maximum. We thought there were six graves, so we purchased eight graves in Memorial Cemetery up in near Montgomery to relocate the graves. By the time we were in the finished with the excavation, we uncovered 31 graves. Most of them never had any tombstones associated with them. And even the John Reynolds tombstone wasn't at the cemetery site. It was in the position of Mrs. Berg. She had visited the cemetery, and it was being destroyed by horses. This was part of a horse farm at one time. The map of the cemetery shows two blue lines of early coffins. The hexagonal coffins are earlier. The rectangular coffins come in at a later date. This cemetery gave us a real good idea of the transition of different burial practices within the Kanawha Valley. All of the remains were analyzed by a physical anthropologist, and we were able to put actual names on some of the graves based on their location, the age, and the age of the individuals. So we named some of Reynolds' daughters and some of Van Pepper Reynolds' daughters. There wasn't much in the way of remains in these graves. Mainly you just got coffin furniture, sometimes some teeth, and so on. A few bones here and there. The children were buried along the edge of the cemetery. No markers. We don't have any idea who they were. The later graves belonged to people who were tenants and occupied the place up till about 1900. The next site is the Glenwood Estate on the west side of Charleston. Glenwood was part of the Bream lands. The original land was a military land grant that included all of West Charleston. When Bream died, the land was split up between his five children in equal parcels. The Glenwood parcel is the one in the middle. The Glenwood quarters, I couldn't find a picture today of the quarters. I have dozens somewhere on my computer, so I had to use this drawing. This is the quarters behind the Glenwood Estate. It served as a kitchen for the main house during the early period and as slave quarters during the period before the Civil War. And it's from this area, when it was purchased or donated to the university, it was donated to COGS originally, then Marshall University took it over, and now it's part of the maintained by the Glenwood Foundation. But they were, a local consulting firm was putting in an air conditioning and heating system and excavated underneath the quarters and came across two features that had a lot of bone and ceramics in it, and a number of other artifacts. And most of the artifacts that we have from this excavation is what we'll base a lot of our interpretations on Glenwood at this time. Now, last fall, we did a number of shovel tests on the Glenwood grounds. There's 2 acres that are owned by the Glenwood Foundation and surround the house, looking for archaeological deposits. These were excavations carried out by my class at the Marshall Graduate College, local volunteers, and volunteers from West Virginia State. Students learned how to record their findings, learned how to interpret the artifacts. Everything was documented with photographs. And in 2 days, we had time to only do one major excavation. It was a 2 meter square in a deposit that went down almost a meter and was filled with nails, broken glass, ceramics, which is typical of these areas. And finally, we did the artifact analysis, which involved washing all of the artifacts, separating them out into different categories, measuring the glass to get relative dates for buildings that were once associated with the house and slave quarters. The advantage of working at Glenwood, though, is that while we haven't done much archaeology at Glenwood, Glenwood has a very extensive documentary history. There's over 400 photographs in the Glenwood collection documenting the house and the Walnut Grove plantation in Putnam County, which was the original plantation owned by the Summers. Summers came into West Virginia in 1810, bought a huge plantation in Putnam County, and then moved to Glenwood in 1857. Now, Summers was a lawyer and was also a member of Congress in the period 1842-1843. We have drawings of some of the outbuildings that are gone now. This is the gate that led up to Glenwood on Park Ave. It was taken out sometime after Stonewall Jackson was built. It was moved at one time and then taken out again. We don't know when. But if you go up Park Ave, you can still see the foundation of one of the gate posts. This is nearly driveway going up to the house. You can tell by the tracks it's during the horse and buggy days, not during the automobile days. There's a whole series of pictures of Summers family members and different automobiles in the collection. Okay, now in terms of comparison of artifacts from all of these sites, one of the interesting things we found in the slave quarters, the Reynolds slave quarters, were Spanish coins. You have two pierced Spanish coins at the top, which are generally associated with slaves. Slaves used to wear pierced coins as earrings and keep them as amulets and so on. The other interesting things is you see a half, a quarter, and two bits, a bit. When you get the term two bits, it comes from the Spanish, how they divided their money. At this time, you didn't have pennies and nickels and dimes. They just cut up the silver coins into smaller pieces for change. In the Kanawha Valley, French and Spanish money was used well into the early 1800s. It was abandoned when the United States finally passed a law that was illegal to use foreign currency. But if you look at some of the historic records, they talk about sending people down to New Orleans along the river and giving them so much money and French gold coins. And we've seen Spanish coins in a number of excavations also. These are artifacts that suggest the slave occupation at the slave quarters on the Reynolds property. The top two are the pierced Spanish coins. D is a piece of pewter that was pierced. And E is a commercial amulet. It's in a design that represents or that suggests a slave occupation with the Congo cosmogram. This is a spiritual item that comes from Africa, actually. When you look at the slave plantations in Tidewater, Virginia, especially like Jamestown, there's been a lot of emphasis on relating the slaves from those plantations to specific areas where they came from in Africa, and then relating some of the artifacts and practices of these slave populations to artifacts and different things that they did in Africa. And in Jamestown, they can associate various slave populations with specific areas in Africa. Now, the top two coins are pierced coins that came from the Jenkins house. Well, it's one penny both sides, and a silver coin from the Reynolds house. Generally, these pierced coins were associated with slave occupations, but there's also oral histories, like in the Clay family in Kentucky. One of the descendants, Burley Clay, was the state archaeologist in Kentucky and worked on both of these excavations, actually, through contracts from a cultural resources analyst. And he indicated that family tradition had that coins were pierced and hung around the necks of babies when they were heathen. And there's some documentation for this in the English literature also. When you look at these coins, they're made with punches and very well made, as opposed to the coins that were found in the slave occupation. So these are probably related to the European occupations in those houses. Another thing we looked at is ceramics. And you get a lot of ceramics in these sites. Probably the most ceramics came out of slave quarters, actually. The plantations had basically expensive ceramics. A lot of it was imported from England. Some of it was even from China and other early potteries in the United States. When you look at the red or ceramics from the slave cabin, you had expensive ceramics. There was pieces of porcelain and transfer printed wares and so on. But the most ceramics, about 70%, consisted of redware, which is the cheapest ceramics available. Redware was often produced locally, and during this excavation, during the literature search, we found out that redware, there was a redware pottery in Charleston, the Shepherd pottery. It was in existence around 1827, 1828. We have the exact location of it in Charleston, but the area is destroyed. There's a big building on it, so we couldn't get any samples or prove that any of this pottery was directly from that particular pottery. One of the things that distinguishes slave occupations from the plantation owners is that in your ceramics that you find at the Jenkins house and Reynolds house, you'll find total sets of ceramics. This is a gold-rimmed saucer and cup from the Jenkins plantation. There was also fragments of platter with a corn design that were excavated from the Jenkins plantation. And when you look into the probate records, when General Jenkins died, these exact ceramics are listed in the probate records, so you know that these were the Jenkins ceramics. The slave cabins, on the other hand, may have some expensive ceramics, but there's never sets. They're isolated pieces that may have been broken and brought from the main house, or they could have been purchased by the slaves themselves. The slaves did have access to money. One of the things that Staley pointed out in his analysis of the salt works in Kanawha Valley is that these slaves were rented mainly from Virginia plantations, but they were required to do certain specific jobs. And if a slave was required to make 6 salt barrels in a week, and he made 7, he would be paid for the 7th barrel. The money would be held until Christmas. The leases for these slaves were 1 year long. They started around New Year's and ended around Christmas. And the money was kept to ensure that the slaves never ran off and so on. One of the analysis that archaeologists use quite extensively is a ceramic cost index. Most of these ceramics, or a lot of these ceramics, have maker's marks or can be identified by time period and sometimes by pottery. They know exactly how much those ceramics cost during that time period. And they can put that into a formula and find out that where, you know, a particular site, particular person was located economically within the community. And here you have a ceramics cost index that shows the lowest index is for a farmer, then a tenant farmer, then a black laborer, a laborer, and Willow Bluff. Willow Bluff is the slave cabin on the Reynolds plantation. It has a higher index because they had access to the ceramics from the Reynolds homestead, and some of the pieces actually match up with the ceramics from the Reynolds homestead. The planter and merchant are the highest, and the planters are the highest. The indexes for the Glenwood, the Reynolds house, and the Jenkins house would be way up there with the planters. In terms of subsistence and animals that were used by these plantation owners and the slaves, at the Jenkins house, beef was the primary food that was found in terms of bones recovered from the kitchen area. Then it was followed by pig. You also had turkey, chicken, bear, raccoon, rabbit, quail, Canada goose, mallard duck, and passenger pigeon. Passenger pigeons were a big food, especially popular when the railroads came through, because they could follow these flocks by telegraph, actually, and harvest them with shotguns. These flocks were so thick, you could shoot a, you know, one shot would take down 10 or 15 birds, actually. They would clean these birds, put them on a railroad car, ship them east, and sell them to restaurants in the east. And in this area, if you look at topographic maps and so on, you'll find places like Pigeon Roost. That's an area where passenger pigeons lived, flocked at one time. There were vast flocks that went through the New River area, on the plantations in the New River area, and several other areas in East Virginia. Reynolds' diet consisted largely of pig, cow, turkey, Canada goose. He also had teal, quail, and passenger pigeon. Glenwood had pig, cow, domestic turkey, chicken, sheep, goat. Archaeologically, you can't tell the difference between a sheep and a goat. So in a lot of reports, they just identify them as sheep, goat. These sheep and goats were domesticated around 7000 BC in the Near East. And you can tell the wild varieties from the domestic varieties, but after that, it's hard to separate. They also had rabbits and dove pigeon. These were bones that were not specifically identifiable. They could have been mourning dove or a passenger pigeon. Pig remains from the slave cabin at the Reynolds slave cabin. Now in the slave cabin, pig makes up 84% of the protein in the diet, followed by cow, chicken, catfish, drum. There was some deer and some other rabbit, other minor animals. In these deposits, there was a high percent of skull, teeth, lower leg bones. These are the bad cuts of meat. It's the type of meat that you use to make stews and porridges out of. This goes along with a lot of the ceramics in the slave cabin, where you find a lot of bowls compared to a few plates. And soups and stews were probably the main source of diet for the slaves. And the slave cabin, they also found rice. And this is one of the things that is indicated in the historic records. During the early 1800s, the major producer of rice was actually in South Carolina. They had huge rice plantations that were eventually wiped out by a hurricane and never reestablished. And when you look at this emphasis on pigs, it's typical of what they call the Upland South tradition. Now, the Reynolds homestead, Glenwood, and the Jenkins house utilized many of the same species of domestic pig and cows. But the major difference is that when you look at the bones at the Reynolds house and Jenkins house and even at Glenwood, they consist of the forequarters, the prime cuts of meat where you get your steaks and roast and chops compared to the lower cuts of meat that were found in the slave quarters. Looking at toys, marbles are pretty much ubiquitous at archaeological sites. We've found these on fort sites. Almost every site, historic site I've excavated has had marbles. These are marbles from the John Reynolds house. Also from the John Reynolds house, we have toy teacups and doll fragments. Toy teacups were very popular in the 1800s as toys for children. And dolls were also very popular. And you generally find doll parts on domestic sites. These are marbles from the Jenkins house. The early marbles were ceramic marbles. The later ones, as you can see, are glass. The Jenkins house was occupied from 1835 up until 1990. Around 1990, the Corps of Engineers bought the house from the local farm family. So there's a whole, you know, a lot of modern debris that you pick up in the excavations, like the modern glass marbles. Dull parts, these marbles, ceramic marbles and dull parts came from the Glenwood Estate underneath the slave cabin. And from the slave cabin at the Reynolds site, you have a Jew's harp, C, and then two or ceramic marbles. So slaves had access to marbles also and various instruments. Sewing pins, these are from the John Reynolds house. Sewing was a very prominent pastime during the 1800s in terms of slave populations as well as the European plantation owners and industrialists also. At the slave cabin, you have four thimbles that were recovered, glass bottle parts, a fork, knife, and spoon. And in terms of, sewing, in the Glenwood collection, there's a series of letters that are published under the name My Dearest Husband, from Amasita Summers to George Summers when he was a congressman in Washington. In December 21st, 1892, she writes, Herbert and I sit up in our room nearly all the time, and Matt, that's the slave Martha, sits in the corner sewing. And throughout these letters, there's several references to sewing, and in the same letter, she says, I had an idea of getting you to give me the pattern from Miss Halliday, a dressmaker in Washington. So Amasita was interested in modernizing her wardrobe and getting cloth. She would ask George to bring cloth back, cloth samples, and she would sew different garments for herself, actually. Smoking pipes, these are from the slave cabin. The one thing about the Reynolds slave cabin is when you look at the dates from the glass that was recovered, it's a very early site. It dates from around 1817 to maybe the 1830s at the latest. The white porcelain or kaolin pipes are early. You generally find those in the 1700s and very early 1800s, and they're replaced by redware ceramic pipes. This is a redware ceramic pipe from the Reynolds house. It has FR engraved on it. This could be Fenton Reynolds or Franklin Reynolds. Fenton Reynolds was buried in the family cemetery. We have a tombstone for Fenton Reynolds, but it was heavily damaged. The date of birth and the date of death were not visible on the tombstone. Fenton Reynolds doesn't seem to show up in the historic records at all. We don't have a date of birth or death for him. Very little information on him. One of the interesting things we came across, though, is Lewis Summers writes in his journal, Sunday, January 22, 1865, William McMullen, Alvin Gorshon, Goshorn, and Fenton Reynolds came home from Dixie. Whether this was the Fenton Reynolds, we don't know. One of the things about these slave owners and industrialists at this time is the names they used for their sons. If you noticed, Jenkins, Albert Gallatin Jenkins. Albert Gallatin was Secretary of the Treasury at the time. The other Jenkins son was named after, all of the sons were named after prominent politicians. Reynolds, Fenton Mercer Reynolds, I'm not sure who, Mercer was a famous name in the Canal Valley, I believe. Writing, lead pencils and writing slate. This was found at the Reynolds house. There were similar artifacts from the Jenkins house. And what was interesting was that there were two pieces of lead and a fragment of writing slate found at the slave quarters at the Reynolds slave quarters. Slaves were not, you were not permitted to teach slaves in Virginia to read or write. But there's documentary evidence that indicates that the slaves of Greenbottom could read and write to a certain extent. In the early records, when the plantation was owned by Virginia governors, there's a listing where a slave was beaten at the can't think of the name of the plantation. It's located near Garrett's Bend Plantation in Kentucky, Louisa, Kentucky. The slave was beaten because it was caught reading. And they said this would have never happened to a slave at the Greenbottom Plantation. And actually, these slaves were from Greenbottom. The governor owned a piece of land in Kentucky and the Greenbottom Plantation. And what they did is when the tax collectors came around, they just shifted the slave population to another plantation to avoid taxes. Okay, a number of other interesting things that we found at the slave cabin, the Reynolds slave cabin, is a number of 1812 military buttons. We went through the historic records and find no indication that anyone in the Reynolds family served in the military or was involved in the world in the War of 1812. You go to the documents for the Tidewater, Virginia plantations, however, and it turns out after the War of 1812, the United States had a surplus of uniforms. So what they did is they sold them to plantation owners for their slave populations. And like I said, most of the slaves, industrial slaves, were rented from Tidewater, Virginia plantations. Another thing that we found at the Reynolds slave cabin was gun parts, gun flints, and bullets. It's something you don't necessarily associate with slaves and slave cabins. But when you go into the Virginia literature on the plantations in Virginia, it was the slaves that did the hunting and provided a lot of the wild game for the plantations. And it wasn't uncommon for slaves to have access to firearms. Now, comparison of the artifacts. This is from an article in wonderful West Virginia. We did a series of articles on the Jenkins house and the archaeological excavations at Marmet. But from the Reynolds house, you can see high status transfer printed ceramics, expensive pipes, and a silver spoon compared to the slave cabin where you have pierced coins, pierced pewter, gun parts, a lot of pig fragments, and pewter forks, knives, and spoons, and redware pottery, which is very, like I said, very cheap and indicative of slave populations. Now, George Summers was the owner of the Glenwood plantation beginning in 1857. He bought it off Lagley. George's wife, Amicetta, was a Lagley, actually. And when you look at the land transfers and business dealings, you'll notice in Charleston, everything was family-oriented. The elite families all dealt with the elite families and so on. Summers served in the Virginia legislature. He ran for governor and lost. It was the first time in Virginia where you had two people from Western Virginia running for governor, and a guy from Clarksburg beat him out. One of the reason Summer's lost is the guy from Clarksburg, I forget his name, portrayed Summers as an abolitionist, even though Summers owned like 20 slaves. Leased slaves. As we said, most of the slaves in McNaught Valley were leased from Virginia Tidewater plantations, but there were plantation owners in the Kanawha Valley that also leased their slaves to some of the salt works. And one evidence of this is that in the legal proceedings at the Kanawha County Courthouse, Summers leased his slave Jim with prohibitions. He could not work in a coal bank or as a kettle tender, nor compelled to work on Sundays. This is from an 1856 court case, Summers versus Humphreys and Graham. There's also another court case similar to this in the Kanawha County Courthouse. And there's probably other leases that we haven't really looked into that show that local plantation owners leased slaves. The reason for the prohibitions were to protect the slaves because they were considered as property, and you didn't want a slave killed or seriously injured while he was working in the salt works. And the most dangerous works were in the coal banks and as kettle tenders, actually. And also, we know that Summers' slaves went to church on Sundays. In one of the letters from Amaceta to George, the slaves began going to a church, I forget, it was a Methodist church, I think, and she was concerned about this because there was a lot of loud singing and dancing going on to all hours of the night, and she didn't know if they would be able to work the next morning. Okay, the wine cellar. At the Glenwood Estate, there are rumors that there was a wine cellar located somewhere there, which we never found during the test excavations. But in the Glenwood house, in the attic, we found these two large wine jugs. And if you look at the historic records in 1860, George Summers was one of two people in Kanawha County that declared having wine. He had something like 40 gallons of wine listed on his agricultural stuff. When you look at the Lewis Summers journals, there's one or two entries about harvesting grapes and making wine. It was interesting because in this area, using local grapes, we usually make Concord and Niagara wine in late August, early September, where Summers was working in October, harvesting grapes and making wine. So these were probably a different variety from the local Concord and Niagara varieties. Okay, that's all I have for today. One of the things I want to stress is that, you know, the Glenwood is an ongoing project in terms of historic research. We may get into more archaeological research there in the future. We'll have to decide what the next step would be and how to go about doing it cost-effectively, maybe doing some remote sensing to locate some of the structures located at the on the property. The other thing is that we have all of these journals from Lewis Summers. Spends about 10 or 15 years, and there's even an agricultural journal from the first year that he took over when his father George Summers died. But some of these have been translated and transcribed by students, but there's several others that haven't been transcribed yet. And there's a lot of other documentary evidence that we're just getting into in terms of the Glenwood collections. We also know that there's a lot of documentary evidence associated with George Summers at WVU, and at some point we'll probably try to get copies of that down here. Are there any questions?
When you were talking about about the Tidewater literature with regard to slaves and the bullets and going and hunting. Is there any difference in time period as that went on? Were they just as likely, as you got closer to the Civil War, to have their slaves hunting as they were earlier? Or?
I don't know. That's a good question. And the other thing in terms of slave economies and so on, when you're looking at West Virginia, you're looking at a very late period. Whereas, you know, at Jamestown, you have slavery, not yet when it was introduced, but it was introduced in the 1600s, and you have like that whole about a century difference. And a lot of the sites that they're excavating in Tidewater are much earlier sites than you find. Actually, West Virginia is a very late period in terms of sites.
Were palisades a common feature of modern Native American villages versus prehistoric Native American? I forget, maybe Reynolds' home, yeah, you excavated the really large area and they had palisades and all that. Yeah. Was that a feature of later Native American?
That village dates to about 1400. Around 1200 AD, you get a transition from horticulture to more intensive agriculture in this area. And, you know, like they talk about Adena villages and mounds and stuff like this. There were no villages prior to about 1200 AD. At 1200, you have a transition from eastern agricultural plants like Unipodium, amaranth, little barley, stuff that we consider weeds today, maygrass, to intensive corn agriculture. By 1200 AD, most of the Indian diet was made up of corn, actually. They can do an analysis on the bones and the ratios. Corn is a C4 plant. It's a tropical plant. It differs from plants in this area, which are C3 plants. And you can get a percentage of radiocarbon that indicates a high corn diet. One of the interesting things is today I always thought, how would modern people do an analysis like that? How do you think they would do? How much corn do you have in your diet?
Artificial sweeteners.
Right. The American diet has more corn in it than in the Mexican diet today because of artificial sweeteners. Well, not artificial, but fructose sweeteners and corn additives to just about everything you buy commercially.
Did the Native Americans use Burning Springs salt?
That's a good question. They, you know, there's stories that the Shawnee brought Mary Ingalls, you know, down when she was captured and made salt at Burning Springs, but there's no historic evidence of that. And, you know, we were looking for something that could indicate salt making, but we never found it. Not sure how. In the later period, during the contact period, around 1600, you find actual salt pans on four ancient sites. But these are sites that have trade goods. In the southeast, you have sites that were salt-producing sites where they have these wide, large ceramic pans that were used to evaporate salt water to make salt. And there are some indications that the Shawnee were actually involved in salt trade prehistorically and during early historic times. But for the woodland period, one thing, there was so much game in the diet that you did need access to salt as you would when you go to a corn diet.
In regards to the Fort Anxious Village on the Reynolds Plantation, was the Reynolds Plantation developed over the village or beside it?
Reynolds was an industrial site, and the only part that was impacted was part of the stockade line was taken out by the Reynolds house. But the village went from the house to the edge of the river, basically. And it had burning springs on one side. And one of the interesting things about the village, everyone talks about Indian villages being circular. And when they excavated the Buffalo Village in the 1960s up in Putnam County, the original publication in the first introduction to West Virginia archaeology had the village as D-shaped. When it came along the river, it was a straight line of houses. And then they changed it to a circular village. But the village at Marmet is D-shaped. When you get to the riverbank, the houses go in a straight line. It didn't go out into a circle. And this has been identified as what we call a woodside phase village. The woodside population started out in the Vavisa Fork in Kentucky, and it seems to move to the Guyandot River in West Virginia. And at Mann, there was a major excavation of the village site, and Logan, the city of Logan, is built on a woodside phase village that has historic trade goods on it. If you remember a couple years back, some State Department put a building on the village and uncovered a lot of variables. And we think that this village was related to the villages up on the Guyandot, Mann and Logan. In fact, that one of the pipes from the village is a real unique ceramic pipe, and the only identical ceramic pipe that we found like it came from the Mann site. When you look at this village, it was not occupied for a long time. We didn't pick it up in surveys because most of the houses had nothing in it except the fire hearth. It was built and abandoned very abruptly. And if you look at the location of the village, there's a bridge that goes from there, from Marmet to Logan, so you have a direct Indian trail probably to the Guyandot with a day's walk or so.
Well, so many of the houses built along the rivers and before Corps of Engineers existed for flood control, did you find evidence of flooding in some of the locations, and are records available for prior floods that would help with data
at all? There are records available. We didn't find evidence in the historic excavations, but in the prehistoric village, the village is at the same level basically as the Reynolds house, and below that, a meter down, is a woodland occupation, and below that is a late archaic occupation. So there was flooding. But it wasn't extensive, it was in a different topographical situation than St. Albans, where you have 17, 18 feet of flood deposits. But you do find, it's one of the interesting things about my job at the Corps of Engineers, we've tried to make it more multidisciplinary, and I had a lot of interaction with other disciplines. And like when our geologists would go out, they would have to determine flood sedimentation rates. Sometimes they would come back and they said, well, we found this pottery, 2 feet below the surface. When does it date to? And I remember one time it was a site up around Parkersburg. I said, it's hotelware. And they said, sure enough, they checked the records. There was a hotel on the site in 18-something, and you had, 2 feet of sedimentation within 100 years. And we would use these techniques on our prehistoric sites also. Yes?
Did you find evidence of the construction of any of these houses? Did you find brick kilns or carpentry?
No. Well, the Jenkins house, most of these houses, like the Jenkins house, supposedly was built with bricks made on the site. And there's a big tree to the left of the site that kind of gave indications it may have been a what they call a brick lamp, where they had made the bricks, but we never looked into it. It had high readings in terms of the remote sensing that we did. And the Jenkins, or the Glenwood, I think there's a location given for where the bricks were made. It was fairly far from the house. It was right on the property.
You said mentioned that there was pillars that used to go up Park to get to Glenwood. There's like a set of pillars almost across from it now. Like, you know, there's that little side street. Was that not an entrance to Glenwood? Or?
No, that's great. I thought maybe the pillars were, you know, replaced there, but after looking at them, it's a much greater introduction. That, you know, Glenwood was divided up in the, originally in the late 1800s, 1870, 1890, around 1900s, you get the division of the upper portion of Glenwood into lots, and around the 1930s and 20s is when you get most of that construction. And that's interesting because the people who live on the west side have no knowledge of, you know, they don't know that these were plantations at one time. And the west side has a very interesting and agricultural history. You have Orchard Manor was a major orchard that produced 100 different types of apples at one time. And Lewis Summers had a dairy farm. Number of dairy farms on the west side and different areas on the outskirts of Charleston.
He had told us one time, I live near Glenwood, and they said that Orchard was like where their orchard was, like Orchard Street, yeah. Garden Street is like where their garden was.
Yeah.
So to speak.
That's probably true. And we do have, in when Glenwood was subdivided into lots, we have a map that shows as you're going up toward Edgewood Drive, there's an area, and there's a couple lots near Cherry Orchard. Mm-hmm. And then way on top, there's a Daisy Hill and the Middle Garden and so on. So, eventually we'd like to reconstruct what the agricultural production was like and where things were placed and so on. But that's going to take an awful lot of work.
So, like, Park is how you would get to Glenwood, because a little, like, right before you get past, or right past Edgewood, there's a carriage trail that goes up the side of the hill, and it looks like they've been cleaning it off. Yeah. So Glenwood didn't have an entrance like that? Or would it have been like that back in the day?
No, Glenwood, that, you know, would have gone straight up Park Ave. And you can see in the one photograph that the entrance to the house was right off Park Ave. There was a deep cut in the road. It was pretty steep for a carriage road, I thought. But right across where Stonewall Jackson is, where they have the school auditorium, that's where the spring was for Glenwood. There's a spring house, and we have all kinds of photos of spring houses torn down probably in the early 1930s before Stonewall was there.
In terms of looking at the three sites from the archaeological study opportunities, what sort of differences does that present? I'm assuming, you know, with the Reynolds site that you had a narrow window of opportunity to do that work, and so just the differences in terms of, you know, the opportunities there.
Yeah, that's a good question. West Virginia doesn't have any real good archaeological programs, and that's why, you know, very little long-term archaeology is done. The only long-term project in West Virginia is the Fort Project. That was started by the McBrides about 20 years ago. And the McBrides were, Steve McBride was in charge of the Glenwood excavation, actually. But, you know, there's a lot of potential, but none of the universities, Marshall has one archaeologist in the field school, and WVU hired an archaeologist, but she's a Mesoamerican expert. She doesn't have any knowledge of this area at all. But when you look at, you know, plantation sites all up and down the Ohio River, all up and down the Kanawha River, you have major plantation sites, slave-based agriculture, and nothing's really been done on it. There's a couple other slave cabins in West Virginia that have been excavated, but compared to what we did at Reynolds and some of these other sites, there were minor excavations. One in the Eastern Panhandle, and one's up around Ripley. And there's one up on the Kanawha River associated with the coal mining facility. But most of these had very little excavation, just partial excavation. Whereas, because this area was in a lock replacement project and was going to be destroyed, we just stripped everything and excavated pretty much everything. Not everything, but and until we got to what they call data redundancy, we keep getting the same thing over and over.
Do these sites relate in any way to the Virginia turnpikes?
Well, the Reynolds site would have been on the Weston Gully Turnpike. The interesting thing about the Glenwood is that it was located on the Parkersburg Turnpike. Washington Street was the Parkersburg Turnpike. And if you go out Washington Street, it crosses Two Mile Creek. You turn off and park in that little area right next to the modern bridge. You can see the old turnpike bridge that was built in the 1830s, the stonework and everything. They put a modern deck over it and then built a bridge right next to it. And the other interesting thing about the west side is during the early history, all of your occupation was on the river. The river was the major source of commerce. You had to be on the river. When you look at Charleston, all of the lots on the river are small lots where you have, you know, river access. When they put in the turnpike, the Parkersburg Turnpike, on the west side, Washington Street, the first mansion that was built was the Little Page mansion on the west side that's still there. And it wasn't built on the river, it was built on the turnpike to service the turnpike. And after that, all of the rich landowners built their houses up on the bluffs, the Cars, the Laidley's, Summers, to get away from the turnpike traffic, basically.
To the Jenkins Plantation, did you find any evidence of earlier occupation, like cattle living there, no, or a house before, no, Jenkins?
that was very frustrating because we know it was occupied from 1775. And supposedly toward the highway, there the original house was supposed to stand somewhere near the highway, where the highway Route 2 went through. But we never found any evidence of it at all.
But did cattle ever stay in that?
What?
Did cattle ever stay in that area?
No, they were absentee landowners. They owned the plantations and they had overseas. That's one reason some of the Glenwood slaves could read and write, because yeah, during the early period in the country, very few people could read and write. If you look at the Revolutionary War records, we have Dunmore, letters from Bluestone, Forts in the Bluestone area. They're pleading, just send me someone who can read and write so they can, we can keep some records. And, you know, they have a whole military garrison with 30, 40 people, and none of them could read and write. And there's some speculation that at Glenwood was a problem. They had to have some slaves who had basic arithmetic and stuff that could keep records of what was going on and so on. You're talking about a 4,000 acre plantation, so water commerce going on. Okay.
Quick observation. When you said the river was the focus of people's commerce.
Yeah.
My grandfather retired to a place that was between the Ohio River and Vienna right away. The door facing the Ohio River to my grandfather was always the front door. That's where right. Grandpa, nobody comes in that door. It doesn't, it just faces a river. But that was the way he thought about it.
Yeah.
With the front door. Another quick trivial question. The wine jugs. How big do you think they were?
I don't know. I think these were big. I had no idea when they date to. I keep thinking I'm going to send this off to some historic archaeologists that I know that specialize in this area. But that's, I make wine, so that's always been a topic of conversation. And the other thing about the historic records, like in the letters of Amaceta Summers, they're always waiting for the riverboat. And that, you know, when they would go to Putnam County, they would go by river rather than carriage. If they were going by to Huntington, they would go by river. If they wanted supplies, they would go to Wheeling or Cincinnati because things were 50% cheaper. So when, you know, if George was coming along the national road down to Wheeling, he was to pick up, you know, a barrel of apples and stuff like this, they'd give him a shopping list. Okay, in terms of publications, there's two small articles, one on Glenwood and the artifacts found in the slave quarters. Another one, kind of a brief overview of the excavations at Marmet. These are just released beneath the Kanawha Valley. This has all three movies that we made at Reynolds Homestead, prehistory movie that was on public TV last night, and Ghost of Green Bottom. And these are $15, these are $10. And if any of you have a VCR, these are free. We're getting rid of our supply. I've been giving these away for 3 years now. The downturn. Well, thank you.
I'd like to thank everyone for attending tonight. Please keep in mind that we will be putting out when our next lectures as we go further into the year. Those will be announced on our website. That's wbculture.org/history. Appreciate you coming. Thank you very much. And be careful going back out.